Hi folks, this is Jay. Hope you're okay today. It's good to see you. We're in our final part, the eight-part series of the story of the Old Testament. Now we've looked at the whole story of the Old Testament from beginning to end. Now, what does all that story mean? So let's just have a look at a few scriptures that can help us to understand that Old Testament story. It's important because you have atheists. The first thing that they will do is they'll go straight to Leviticus as the interpretation of the Old Testament. The Muslims will say that Muhammad is in the Old Testament. So what does this Old Testament story of the people of Israel all mean for us today? Well, let's look at Luke chapter 17, 29. Luke 17. And 29, our Lord Jesus Christ says, "But on the day that Lot went out of Sodom, it rained fire and brimstone from heaven and destroyed them, ye all. Even so will be in the day when the Son of Man is revealed." So what we see there is our Lord Jesus Christ, and he says, remember Lot's wife. He's saying that Sodom and Gomorrah was a real historical event. So that story I've told you over seven videos about Genesis, God creating the world, about Noah's flood, and about Abraham, and about King David and King Saul and the captivity and Nehemiah, etc. It's a real story. It's a historical fact, because the Lord Jesus Christ saw the Old Testament as historical fact. That's important because skeptics like the atheist and liberals, people theologically are people who just don't believe the Bible is inspired. They think that there is nothing historically true about the Old Testament, and Jesus is saying it is. Then if you turn to John chapter 10, 35, John 10, 35, it says, "If he called them gods to whom the word of God came, the scripture cannot be broken." So our Lord's referring to the Old Testament. So not only is the Old Testament historical, it is also authoritative. It cannot be broken. So the attacks that the atheists are putting on the scripture by going to Leviticus and saying God's a moral monster, Jesus is saying scripture cannot be broken. The Old Testament is the Word of God. When our modern culture criticizes the Bible and the Old Testament, Jesus saying it is of God, it cannot be broken. All right, then if you turn to Luke 24, Luke chapter 24, verse 13 to verse 32. "Now behold, two of them were travelling that same day to a village called Emmaus, which was 7 miles from Jerusalem. They talked together of all these things which had happened. So it was, while they conversed and reasoned, that Jesus himself drew near and went with them. But their eyes were restrained, so that they did not know him. And he said to them, What kind of conversation is it that you have with one another as you walk and are sad? Then one whose name was Cleopas answered and said to him, Are you the only stranger in Jerusalem, and have you not known the things which happened were in these days? He said to them, What things? So they said to him, The things concerning Jesus of Nazareth, who was a prophet, mighty indeed and word before God and all the people. And how the chief priests and our rulers delivered him to be condemned to death and crucify him. But we were hoping that it was he who was going to redeem Israel. Indeed, beside all this, today is the third day since these things happened. Yes, and a certain woman of our company who arrived at the tomb early astonished us. When they did not find his body, they came saying that they had also seen a vision of angels who said he was alive. A certain of those who were with us went to the tomb and found it just as the woman had said, but him they did not see. Then he said to them, O foolish ones and slow of heart to believe, and in all that the prophets have spoken, ought not Christ to have suffered these things and to enter into his glory? Now here's the key. This is Luke 24:27. This is the key. And beginning at Moses, this is Jesus, and beginning at Moses and all the prophets, he expounded to them in the scriptures the things concerning himself. So the Old Testament, the Lord is saying, it was all about Jesus, was all about him. So you can't really be looking at the Old Testament in a proper way unless you see Jesus. Then they drew near the village where they were going, and he indicated that he would have to go farther, but they constrained him, saying, "Abide with us, for it is towards evening, and the day is far spent." And he went in to stay with them. And now it came to pass, as he sat at the table with them, that he took bread, blessed and broke it, and gave it to them. Then their eyes were opened, and they knew him, and vanished, and he vanished from their sight. And they said to one another, "Did not our hearts burn within us while he talked with us on the road, and while he opened the scriptures to us?" The disciples could not understand the Old Testament unless Jesus opened their eyes. And you cannot understand the Old Testament unless you ask the Holy Spirit to open your eyes. It's no good going to the Old Testament with critical eyes. You've got to go asking the Holy Spirit to open your eyes, and you will see amazing things if you ask the Holy Spirit to teach you. And then if we go to Hebrews chapter 9. So, number one, Jesus says the Old Testament is historically true. Number two, Jesus says the Scripture, Old Testament, is authoritative, cannot be broken. Number three, he says it's of him. Okay? So that is a direct opposite to atheism understanding of the Old Testament and the Islamic understanding of the Old Testament. This is Jesus' authoritative understanding of the Old Testament. And you're to listen to him, not Muhammad, nor the atheist, but Christ. And then if we go to Hebrews chapter 8, it says, "Now this is the main point of the things we are saying. We have such a high priest who is seated at the right hand of the throne of majesty in heaven, a minister of the sanctuary of the true tabernacle, which the Lord erected, and not man. For every high priest is appointed to offer both gifts and sacrifices, therefore it is necessary that this one also having something to offer. For if he were on the earth, he would not be a priest, since there are priests who offer the gifts according to the law, who serve the copy and shadow of heavenly things, as Moses was divinely instructed when he was about to make the tabernacle. For he said, 'See that you make all things according to the pattern shown on you on the mountain.' But now he has obtained a more excellent ministry, inasmuch as he is also a mediator of a better covenant, which was established on better promises." And then it says in Hebrews chapter 8 verse 10, "For this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel for those days, says the Lord. I will put my laws in their minds, write them on their hearts, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people." So what this is teaching is that there is an old covenant and a new covenant in the Old and New Testament. The old covenant and the new covenant. The new covenant was when the Spirit of God came in people's hearts. Okay, so there is a difference between the Old Covenant and the New Covenant. It's the covenant of grace and the covenant of works. It's the covenant of law, it's the covenant of grace. Jesus Christ came for grace and truth. Okay? So when you're reading the Old Testament, it's of the Old Covenant. And when you're reading the New Testament, you're reading the New Covenant. The New Covenant is when the Spirit of God dwells in people's hearts. And when you're reading the Old Testament, you're looking at a book that is a shadow of the New. It is pointing to the New Testament. It is pointing to the New Covenant. So everything you see in the Old Testament, like the high priest that was in the time of Moses, was a picture that Jesus was going to be the high priest. When the high priest sacrificed animals, it was a picture that Christ would be a sacrifice for our sin. You see. What that means is, when you're reading the Old Testament, you've got to be realizing that it's pointing to Christ. That's the first thing. The second thing is, you know, when you see difficulties, passages in the Old Testament, realize that it is the Word of God, it cannot be broken, it is historically true, try to find Christ in that difficult passage, but also realize that that difficult passage is only a shadow of the new. All right? In other words, the laws, some of the laws that Israel were given were for Israel as a nation. They were not meant to be taken to the future. So, for example, God had Moses build a tabernacle, a tent. Now, we don't have a tent today. The tent was a symbol that the temple would come, and the temple was a symbol that Christ would come. But we don't have a temple today, and we don't have a tent today. You see, it was only meant for the people of Israel of that time, but it was also speaking about the future of Christ coming. So that's an example. So when the atheists point to Leviticus text, they don't realize they're only a shadow of the future Messiah. They weren't meant to be forever, apart from the Ten Commandments. Okay? When Muslims say, well, Muhammad's in the Bible, in the Old Testament. No. The Old Testament was a prophecy, a pointing to the New Testament, to the New Covenant, which was Christ and the Spirit of God coming into believers' hearts. Alright? Thanks for listening, and I hope you're okay. And we finished our series on the Old Testament, and I'll just close in prayer. Dear God, we just looked at the whole of your Old Testament, Lord, in all its vastness, and Lord, we just come to you today, and we just thank you for your grace and your love and your care. And I just pray that this series will be a blessing. It would convert people, it would restore people, it would strengthen people, it would rebuke people, but Lord, above all, it would bring you glory. So Lord, I pray that this series will be blessed in your name and for your glory. Amen. Amen. I'll leave you some resources underneath this video if you want to pursue the studies even further. Thank you.